Hi everyone. Thank you for joining us. As Vikyat was saying,
In a sense, an intro towards the end, actually.
this is part of no worries. This is part of a larger business and leisure series by NSRCL. We have four of us from the Bloom ecosystem, Bloom team, and a couple of our founders as part of this. So thanks a lot for NSRCL and the volunteer team. For having us, and more importantly for all of you guys to join. It's a great audience. Just to set some context, I work with Bloom. We also have Sanjay Nath, who's the managing partner and co-founder of Bloom Ventures. Alongside the two of us, we have two of our founders. One is Shashank from Tapchief, and we have Nikhil Mujani, who's one of the senior and early folks at Healthify Me. The idea today is to walk through, obviously, we're all going through extremely unprecedented times. I'm sure all of you have attended enough webinars, so I'm not going to repeat that. But broadly today, the idea is for us to share some of our insights around, specifically around sales, what we are seeing across the tailwinds, and how can some of the early stage companies approach both sales and partnerships. So I'm just going to quickly walk you through how this is going to get structured. We are going to have the first about, I would say, 45 minutes to an hour, beginning with Sanjay and I, just setting some context around what we are seeing around sales and partnerships, about 10 minutes each. We're then going to take up, I'm going to let Shashank and Nikhil talk a little more specific about how they have seen sales evolve and marketing evolve, let's say in a B2C context, for their startups in the last 8 weeks. And post that, we can take up questions. As you can see, there's a Q&A tab at the bottom, which you can use to take these up. We'll try to answer as many as possible. Whichever we can't, we will try and take it up separately. I will do add a caveat. Let's try and keep the focus of the session largely around sales. It's very difficult for us to get into a, just because we're a venture capital firm, I don't want to turn this into a fundraise focused discussion, because it'll probably deviate from the larger discussion here at the moment. So that's broadly it. So I'm just going to quickly share my screen, and we can begin post that. Yeah, Sanjay, would you like to take over?
Sure. Jitesh, can you hear me? Can everyone hear me okay?
Yeah, all good.
Cool. First of all, thanks to our friends at NSRCL, Vikyat, Keshav, and Shiva, and the whole group for having us. So it's a pleasure for Bloom and two of our portfolio companies to be here today. Jitesh, do I have control, or you just go?
I'll change the slides.
Yeah, just next one. Yeah, we can start. So as Jitesh explained, I think the title is about the art and science about sales and everything around sales, especially given the situation we are in. You've probably heard a lot of seminars about funding and about HR and about other aspects. But we'll go more deeply into this, and then happy to take questions later. So I'll go a little deeper into some of the slides and just read off them per se. But I think the first, it's helpful to start with the tailwinds and trends that we are seeing right before we dive into sales. So one of the things we see is the digital has come back rather to the forefront, right? If you look at, think about the Facebook Jio deal, it's interesting it's come at this time that actually shows, right? Look at the ramifications for WhatsApp, for Facebook, for retail, for Kirana shops. One of our colleagues, Sajid Pai, has actually written in detail about what it means. And that is, I think, a perfect example of how digital is just going to get accelerated. And we as Bloom, as a digital VC in that sense, find ourselves at the forefront. Specific sectors, if you look at, tailwinds will certainly touch some sectors more than others. Many of you in Bangalore are familiar with Unacademy. Of course, that's become a national brand now. Online and EdTech is certainly at the forefront because, I think the future of edtech had already changed, and now it's changing even more, irreversibly in that sense. So they're clearly a recipient. If you look at areas like health, Nikhil later is going to talk about. Jidesh, can you move this thing out? Oh, okay. Sorry, my poll just popped up. I'm sorry. I apologize. If you look at healthcare, right? Nikhil is going to talk about health, telemedicine, or even health advice before that example. As an example, is another example of a tailwind where people are spending more time on their mobiles, and today you can do Skype and yoga and stationary cycling and all that good stuff virtually. And again, Shashank will also talk about future of work, which is again interesting, which impacts touches productivity tools, education, and just the way we as professionals will work and interact. So it's clearly bringing digital to the forefront. The second point is, and we talk about this later also about vitamins versus painkillers. I think the divide between essential and non-essential will become even more. So from a sales perspective, it's very important to understand if you're whatever you're selling, the product or service, is it a nice to have or is it a must have? How do you get into that essential category? And that may also expand. So I think that's critical for salespeople and CEOs to think about. The third one is, the way of selling, again, and this also ties into the future of work, is it might, permanently sell for the future. I'll give you an example. We were talking, Bloom, we are an early stage VC. The latest fund was about $100 million fund. And we do both consumer and enterprise B2B, global B2B. We were talking to one of our companies in the Valley, and they actually just closed a $100,000 contract with a large, FMCG company, which was, they had the relationship, but they basically essentially closed that deal via email and Zoom. So the whole idea is that is also here to stay. The way salespeople and CEOs will sell and interact with customers will change. Inside sales, a very important time. I think this is a great time to hunker down with product, to look at lead generation, to look at marketing. How do you keep in touch and engage with your existing customers and use different parts of sales, right? The sort of sales support. And that's what inside sales is. So I think that aspect is going to take off. And as companies, you might also make some hiring moves in that direction. The fourth one is really, this is also a time, you may have heard of seminars where JD.com, for example, was created in the SARS downturn, right? They had SARS, and the founder actually, all the malls were closed, and he actually came up with this platform called JD.com. You probably heard that Airbnb and Uber were also started after the 2008 financial downturn. So these were started also because there were some changes in behavior on both sides. So on the consumer side, certain tailwind or lift sectors will take off. And obviously on the enterprise side, we are going to see, more move to the cloud, autonomous remote systems with social distancing and less human contact. You will see AI and voice and, a lot of the backbone of infrastructure and application layers disrupting industries. So we'll see in some cases permanent, in some cases maybe temporary changes in behavior. And again, future of work, I think, is certainly a permanent shift, because I think the era of the typical corporation, working, 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, is going to change. People and CEOs and boards will really think about where's the biggest bang for the buck, where can you minimize commute. So this is important, just to start the tailwinds. Jidesh, next slide, thanks. So I'm sure a lot of you read, and a lot of you all have your favorite books and blog posts and podcasts. I think a very simple and not a very heavy reading, but very insightful and incisive reading is Peter Thiel's 0 to 1. And in that, he covers sales a lot. And I was just taking a look at, given the topic, I was taking a look at the book again. The first bullet point is interesting, right? None of us, just put yourself in the shoes of a consumer. None of us wants to be sold anything, right? Not a single one of us. If you look at companies that are acquired, they're always bought, right? It's the buy side. There is like, if Cisco is buying AppDynamics, it's because they saw a gap, they saw a hole. Salesforce bought MuleSoft, they saw a hole, right? Nobody sells a company. So we always like to say, some things are bought, things are acquired, not sold. So sales always works best when it's hidden, right? That means you've got to make a very strong sales pitch, but it has to be subtle, right? You don't, you want to make a value proposition and communicate that, but it's not a hard sell, right? The customer feels that you're helping him. The second is, and this is the second point about viral marketing is even truer now. In good times, you know, especially with the likes of SoftBank and the others, lots of companies were raising billions of dollars, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars. In that sense, it's very difficult to tell whether your measurable outcomes are coming from paid or viral marketing. And viral is really interesting because it means the product is selling itself, right? It is on the strength of the product that it's taking off. And this will become even truer now when, you know, wallets dry up and when VCs start investing a little less in controlling costs. So the third one is also a favorite quote of mine, you know, Mike Maples, who ex-entrepreneur and now with the Floodgate VC in the Valley. Think of a salesperson as, you know, it is not a linear process, right? Where you believe in a product. You actually have, and you go through five bullet points and say, you know, you have that probable tick mark and say, okay, here's a product comparison. I've gone through it and we have all the five check marks, right? You really have to move that buyer beyond their logic, right? Help them understand and empathize why your product meets their needs, what their needs are. And Jitesh is also going to talk about the whole concept of partnership later. But the whole idea, which I liked, is founders have to be like artists, right? They can't just be engineers. And which is why our deck was also titled The Art and Science of Sales, right? Both sides are very important. And the fourth is very critical. Again, quoting Reid Hoffman, I think what we've seen is that however good the product, if you don't have a strong distribution channel, for example, you know, Mark Zuckerberg very early on was very innovative. I mean, it was a fantastic idea to launch, you know, the likes of Friendster and then Facebook on college campuses because that hits all of these, right? It's viral. The students have nothing to, there's no hidden incentive there. They like it, they're all going to use it. And the value increases with the network effect. So that was a fantastic distribution channel. So I would encourage startups and founders to almost think about these in parallel, right? You don't say 1 year, I'll just build product and then I'll think about how to distribute it. And I think the NSRCL is a great network, right? The fact that you have so many folks listening is also a great distribution tool to test something out. So distribution is absolutely critical. Yeah, Jitesh, thanks. So, you know, we've been running a couple of webinars and many of them have been focused mainly on enterprise B2B. And this slide is about in this market, it's not that the door will be shut on new business development, but it's very important to protect, just like you're protecting our family and friends, it's very important to protect your current customers, right? So for a B2C company, it is deeper engagement, even as your customer base is taking off, are you engaging more with your current customers? On the B2B side, you almost become, you know, get into the role of an account manager and a relationship manager, move from sales mode and say, you know, how do I better protect this revenue? Can I upsell? So obviously, how well do you know your customers, right? Today, it's never more important today. Otherwise, you're all, you know, excited about that new deal, right? Let's go and sign that new contract. It's really, really important to do this. The 80-20 rule, I would say, you know, 80% focus on your current customers. And of course, you have to add growth, you have to add revenue. Maybe assign a different team to look at new business development because they're really, it's really important. And put yourself in your customer shoes today. You know, if they're large customers, what are their pain points, right? How are they being impacted? If they had a board meeting, what do you think their top three bullet points are? And if you can meet at least one, and if two is a winner, slam dunk, but even if you can meet one of their bullet points, you have your answer, right? How it's all about increasing that customer relevance. How are you staying today very relevant to your customer needs and empathize? And the last point is empathy. We talked about this earlier about the art, about, you know, moving from, all of us love to sell, right? Moving from sales mode to empathize mode, listening in, you know, running surveys. I know the survey just came out. How can we be more relevant to you? You'll be amazed. I'll tell you this. I tweeted about this also. On one hand, on the negative side, we are all quote unquote Zoom prisoners. On the other side, you'll be really surprised how, in a sense, everybody's locked in. This is the equalizer. Everybody's sitting in their living rooms or wherever on Zoom. You'd be surprised how open and people are with time if they see value on the other side. Actually, in good times, people are busy because people are either on a plane or spending 3-4 hours of the entire day commuting. Now you actually have people's attention. So if you have a good sales message, you'd be surprised how open people are with their time and their willingness on the other side to engage. So I would say this is the best time to actually make it more of a conversation than a pitch, right? Say it should always be a conversation. I think now Zoom and other tools are enabling the strength of the conversation to be even stronger. Next one. I think this is the last one. So we talked about this, right? Again, the heading is about, the retreat reload attack is, in a sense, take one step back to take three steps forward, right? Take stock of the situation. What are the headwinds, tailwinds? Headwinds are, issues that are facing our business a little negatively. Tailwinds are, of course, the ones that are, positive for us. One step back to take three steps forward. And again, coming back to essentials, right? That are you a vitamin or are you a painkiller? Because if you're a painkiller, you're a must-have. If you're a vitamin, that's great. But it's a nice to have, right? I'll postpone my purchase decision tomorrow. Do I need it now? I'll just breeze through this. I think here, constantly just revisit the value proposition and is there measurable impact? I think that's bullet number one. The second part is interesting. I'll give you an example. We have a B2B company. Thanks, Jitesh, for putting this in. The second one is a actionable insights B2B company that's based in the Valley. And what they do is they analyze structured, unstructured data and pull out actionable insights that will help retailers and e-commerce companies, find out which are the fastest moving products that sell, which SKUs you need to order fast because it's running out of stock. And interestingly, in a bull economy, they were not able to sign up some of these customers. Now, because of the delivery part of e-commerce, right, whether it be alcohol or whatever it is, everybody's getting things delivered home. And we also heard that Instacart, for example, is hiring 300,000 workers in the US. Amazon is hiring 100,000. So that's a tailwind that's taking off. So if this company took a step back and said, how do I reorient my sales strategy? And was actually able to sign on some of these customers now that they were not able to sign up in regular times. So I think it's a really interesting example of that pieces these elements together, right? You take a step back, retreat, reload, understand your customer better, and then, position your distribution channel. So for example, for this is a tailwind for them. And then the last point, we talked about inside sales that it's a big time to build product. One way to think of it is, you have 2 years master's programs. NSRCL is also affiliated with IIM Bangalore. In one sense, think of it like a 1 year graduate program where, the economy has been hit. You're entering school and you're going to graduate in a year. What is that one activity that in a good time you are not doing a lot of and focus on that, right? So building product, lead generation, marketing, inside sales are great examples because they will actually, Nikhil, I know, is an avid, athlete. And it is akin to strengthening your core right, at this time. Inside sales, generation, lead generation, marketing is, you're strengthening your core now. So by the time the recovery comes back, you're positioned to, attack on it. So yeah, those are the points. I think in summary, I would say it's very important to understand what the tailwinds are, take a deeply engage with your customers, and then, reposition and tweak your sales strategy. So, Jitesh, I'll turn it over to you.
Great. Thanks, Sanjay. That was insightful. I'll just add a couple of more tactical points just as I was, Sanjay was speaking. I think a couple of things as sales folks you'll probably face in terms of realities is how do you manage things like a customer coming and renegotiating contracts, things like that. I think largely, at least from what we have seen in our portfolio and some of the sales leaders there, Shashank and Nikhil can add. Generally, I think that's where the true empathy and communication becomes important. And trying to maybe not go into discounting mode and looking at a larger deal value or a longer contract, I would say would go a longer way. So that's probably another thing I'd like to add. The rest we can take up during the Q&A part anyway. That you guys might have. We'll just move on to the next bit, which I'm going to take up. So while Sanjay covered a lot of, more sales stuff over the next 10-12 minutes, my intention is to just walk you all over through a bit on partnerships. why we think it's relevant is because I think a lot of people misunderstand what partnerships truly mean. A lot of times people confuse between sales and partnerships, while I think they're completely different. To begin with, I'm just going to set a quick backdrop of what's happening in the ecosystem. I think India is fast evolving from where it was a few years ago, and now most people end up doing multiple things. So for example, corporates from a time when they would not engage with small companies, I think have far evolved quite a lot to try and set structured programs, whether that's through incubation teams, innovation teams, or setting up different accelerators. They've also started to invest directly in companies. Same goes for VCs who would normally just invest in companies, now actually play a larger role inside, trying to actually help in the operations of how to grow the business. And then on the third side, I think there are larger ecosystem players like AWS, Microsoft, who for most of you may think like they're probably just actually giving credits. But there are far, far more value adds to be driven. And I'll take you through a couple of examples in the next couple of slides. There are also obviously consulting firms like Bain, BCG, Accenture, who do a ton of work. I'm not sure if any of them are on the call right now, but they do a ton of work behind the scenes, trying to help be relevant. See, because ultimately for a lot of this set of people, it's about relevance. And everybody has to adapt and evolve, and is why you see a lot of mishmash in terms of what everybody is doing. What this results actually is very interesting white spaces for a lot of startups to think of how they can position themselves. Just on that note, I just want to spend 2 minutes on what is a partnership exactly. I think a lot of people confuse, as I was saying, it with sales. It's not a purchase order at all. It's much, much deeper than that. It's essentially just a part of your sales strategy. Please don't confuse it by just having a logo or just the fact that a large company wants to talk to you, they're interested in a partnership. Absolutely not. It's probably going to go way, way longer than just one call or a couple of calls. We often get this sense of, just having a meeting and talking to them should work. Absolutely not. I think it's about going much deeper. Partnerships normally feed into your sales strategy as a subset. And while in some cases, as I said, just having the logos makes sense, in a lot of times it's a lot of effort and time. I think as an early stage company, you really have to think hard and fast whether you think you're in a position to invest this kind of time or not. I've seen in a lot of cases where instead of going for sales, which is probably be a short term, like a sales cycle, startups end up going hiring folks on the BD side or partnership side, and without realizing it actually takes months, if not more, to actually convert something. And then, it results in challenges. I think the best partners sort of have the same sort of customers that you would have. And the ideal scenario is when the combined offerings actually benefit the customer far more, right? Because that's where the true example can be presented. So I'll take an example. For example, InMobi, you may have heard of, as a large ad tech company. They work with Microsoft. I remember talking, Naveen was on a session once, and I think the partnership essentially took a few years to actually go through. But the idea is actually a win-win for both, because Microsoft has a large number of customers which will take Microsoft more seriously if InMobi is there. And for InMobi, it opens up a large revenue opportunity in one shot. So while what we read, much like other things, as a confirmation bias, is just the news of, let's say, a partnership actually happening, there are tens and thousands of nuances that are going behind the scenes, and it probably took a few years to do that. So I think, which is why the approach of trying to look at what a partnership becomes very relevant. At the same time, I think it's important to identify the right partners. I'll give you a couple of hacks on this. I'm sure a lot of folks on this call, you would be wanting to deal with large companies, with large corporates. I remember when I was a founder, just getting an inbound request from a large company in my website would make us, just jump off and feeling, okay, great, like they want to talk to us. But in reality, it's never that easy. That person sometimes doesn't respond. It just turns out that it's not legit. And I think one of the ways that at least large companies have solved this or trying to solve this is trying to set up these dedicated innovation teams, which help in some of these partnerships and POCs. I think one way to look at if a particular company would be relevant or not is to see if they have a partnerships team or not. Because an ROI on some of these things is very long term, a lot of companies which are truly not focusing on partnerships would actually not get or hire a dedicated partnerships team. Like, I'll tell you, for example, one of the lenses that we look at within a lot of corporate partners is this. So if I were to be presented with 10 large companies in India who all have innovation teams, just seen by the team size will tell us how deep in their innovation they are, right? Because accordingly, they'll be able to understand and help the startups. Like, for example, Intel does a phenomenal job at setting up some of these initiatives because they have a large team dedicated with a senior person involved who goes all out. Same with AWS, same with Microsoft and some of these other folks. Well, I would say there's some sectors, I would say more traditional core Indian businesses, which are, I think, lagging behind. So I think I would be careful on filtering with some of these. That's equally applicable to sales also, actually. The second, I think, is more around the motivation. It's very important to see what the other person has to gain from this. So I'll give you an example. One of our companies in the testing space, they reached out to us saying, "Hey, we want to partner with Microsoft." It's obviously, as a founder, it just becomes that simple, right? That, okay, listen, I want to partner. But it actually took us about 3 months and multiple conversations to actually figure out what the partnership would look like, because it's a far more strategic discussion. Now, I think the real question to also ask yourself as a founder is, do you have that much time to spend on this? Which is why, to my earlier point, I think it's important to focus on when this is necessary. So that's why strategic thinking and how really understanding what the other side's goal is, it becomes critical for you to really do the 1+1 > 2 equation here. And to be honest, authenticity can't be fake. It's a two-way street. So we're all in this business. I think any smart person figures out if you're just trying to be fake, and that will never work in the long term. It's a classic rule of networking where we say that you have to give. The same thing applies here. We've personally seen that in huge success with a lot of our companies, some we actually even help with. So I think that can be a good benchmark to take forward. The last bit is just, I think, about thinking of the type of partnerships that exist. They're just divided broadly four. One is obviously go-to-market, which is market access. So for you, does that give you access to a much bigger market and hence, opening up more doors? Or does it give you access, for example, second to distribution, which Sanjay was talking about earlier, right? The third and a much more deeper one is actually joint development. A lot of time, large companies actually work with startups to develop a joint solution, which makes them even stronger. I've actually seen this case even in a lot of consulting firms, which I think will go a long way in really working well. Third, obviously, is linked to the first one, which is, again, a little more customer access, probably more relevant to B2C companies. So I'll give an example for some of you. I'll name a couple of portfolio companies. So we work with Dunzo, is one of our portfolio companies. So think about any such name with some of these lenses and think that, okay, if I have to work with Dunzo, which one of these things can I tick off? And that will help refine a lot of your thinking towards the benefits on both sides. That's probably about it in this. One last point I'd like to add. I think one of the biggest tailwinds we are seeing here is that with large companies, large corporates, the digital transformations that were going to happen, essentially, digitizing right from getting people to work from home or various other aspects, is just going really quickly. What that means for startups is that I think it's very challenging anyway to reach out to large companies because, you're a small startup in anyway. So I think it's equally important, I think, to go through the right partners. And I would reiterate, I think folks like, again, a lot of tech companies, all the larger big tech companies, and even a lot of consulting firms run excellent programs on this. And I think sometimes it's better to go through a partner purely because of trust. And often trust is the biggest thing to win, right? So I think I would encourage a lot of you to think of these from that lens as a long-term strategy. which I think can help move the needle. That's largely it on this. I'll move this over to Nikhil and Shashank. Just a quick brief introduction about the two of them. As I was saying, I let Nikhil go first. Nikhil works with Healthify.me. It's a fitness app, and he'll tell you more. Both Nikhil and Shashank are now going to focus on, again, just a few minutes, specifically around the business that they're in, and more specifically around COVID in terms of what tailwinds they've seen and how they've rejigged and removed their teams alongside it. So Nikhil, over to you, and Shashank, maybe you'll go after this.